Okay, now as we saw last week, the subject this week, we're going to look at Solomon. And as in all these classes, we have a lot of material to go through. I don't know what we're going to do when we get to the prophets. It's like 1 week on the prophets. I don't know how we're going to handle that, but we'll see. But Solomon is who we're looking at. But first, I wanted to remind you that we saw last week that David committed adultery with Uriah's wife, Bathsheba. And when she informed him that she was pregnant, he tried to cover it up by having Uriah. He calls Uriah back from the battlefield, tries to get him to go sleep with his wife so he could dodge responsibility. Uriah refuses to do that. And when that failed, David had Uriah killed in battle. And then he took Bathsheba to be one of his wives. Now, God was greatly displeased with what David had done, which you can well imagine. And he told David through the prophet Nathan that the child conceived through his adultery with Bathsheba would die. And that death is reported in 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 18. And though it's commonly assumed that the child died in infancy, nothing is said about the child's age when the child died. It's simply described as a child. So it seems possible to me that other sons were born before that child, that son, died, and then Solomon was the first son born after that child's death. You see what I'm saying? So you have this child. We normally assume that the child dies as an infant, but he's simply described as a child. So perhaps that child was allowed to grow 6 years old, 7 years old. Other sons being born, that child dies, and then Solomon is the first son born after that child. You see, and then you say, well, why would the names of the others not be mentioned? And it's perhaps because the focus of the narrator is on Solomon as the successor of David's throne. And as Solomon is the one who was born when David went in to comfort Bathsheba after the death of that son. And so maybe that's what's going on, that he brought peace after the death of that son. Now, why do I mention that? Well, that would explain why Solomon is listed as the fourth son. When you have the listings of David's sons born in Jerusalem, they're listed three times, and they're always in the same order, and Solomon is always the fourth one. And you see that in 2 Samuel 5, 13 to 16, 1 Chronicles 3, 5 through 9, 1 Chronicles 14, 3 to 7. Then the first of those four sons who are born to David in Jerusalem. You had six sons born in Hebron. Then you have these sons that are born in Jerusalem. The first four sons born there, those sons are referred to or said in 1 Chronicles 3, 5 to have been the sons of Bathsheba. She's called in 1 Chronicles 3, 5, Bathsheba. But it's understood that's Bathsheba. In fact, a number of translations just skip the confusion and put Bathsheba in there. So she is the mother of those four sons, and Solomon is always listed fourth. So, you know, it looks like that there are other sons born. So if that's what happened, then that would explain why Solomon is listed as the fourth son. Now, another possibility is that the listings of Bathsheba's four sons are for some reason not in chronological order. Okay, well, that's possible. If that's the case, then there's no question about it. There's no issue. Solomon could have been simply the second son born to Bathsheba after the son of adultery dies, if they're not in chronological order. But one of the things that gives me some hesitation about that is that the sons who were born in Hebron, those six sons clearly are given in chronological order. So one would at least expect that the sons born in Jerusalem were given in chronological. It wouldn't have to be, but you would be leaning. So anyway, so I just wanted to point that out about the about Solomon, and what I think, you know, is possibilities, what could be going on. You know, is he the seventh son born? You know, you've got the six in Hebron, you've got the one that died, then Solomon, or are they having technical difficulties in addition to being ugly? Okay, and as I said at the end of class, thank you guys. At the end of the class last week, it seems that Solomon was designated to be David's successor around 973 BC. This is at the end of David's life. He's getting close, just has a couple more years to live. But it seems he's designated as his successor. And this was the time when David was charging Solomon regarding the building of the temple, a project for which he'd made a lot of preparation. So he's charging Solomon what he wants to do, and he appoints him, lets him know that he is going to be his successor. So there's kind of this less formal appointment of Solomon as the successor. And that appointment apparently didn't sit well with Solomon's older brother Adonijah. Being the older brother, and perhaps he was the oldest surviving brother, but being the oldest brother, maybe the oldest surviving brother, it seems that he felt like the kingship should go to him. And you can see how that he thought he was the appropriate one to follow David on the throne. So as told in 1 Kings chapter 1, Adonijah, he gets Joab and Abiathar the priest. Now, both of those had long loyalties to David. You remember Abiathar was the priest who escaped when Saul slaughtered the priest at Nob. And he went to David. And Joab was David's commander for a long time. But Adonijah got them on board with his plan. And he just declared himself to be the king. And he was trying to circumvent David's intention that Solomon succeed him on the throne. And so he goes ahead and he's got this plan. He gets these guys, Joab, Abiathar, he gets them on board. He declares himself king. And when David's alerted to that plan, Nathan and Bathsheba, they move David to action. He then arranged for Solomon to be brought before the people for this formal appointment, this coronation, this big public thing where everybody's going to see that he is in fact the king. And that's why it says in 1 Chronicles 29, 22, it refers there to Solomon being acknowledged king a second time. I think that's what's behind that. So he was less formally appointed. And then when you have this thing with Adonijah, he's then this formal coronation. And what happens is Adonijah's gathered with all of his supporters and his people. He's proclaiming himself king. They hear all this noise. They say, what's this? Well, this is all of the people celebrating Solomon's appointment as king. Okay, so when they realize that they'd been beaten to the punch and that the people are celebrating Solomon's coronation as the king, well, the supporters of Adonijah, they take off because they understand what this means, that they've cast themselves now against the king, and that's not a good thing to have in that world. So they all scatter because they know what that means. And Adonijah, he feared that Solomon would kill him, because he was trying to take the throne from Solomon. But Solomon let him live on the condition that he not again manifest disloyalty to Solomon as king. So he says, no, I'm not going to kill you. But you don't do anything like it. You be loyal. You be righteous. I'm going to be watching. And so he tells him that. And then in 1 Kings chapter 2, David at the end of his life, he instructs Solomon to be courageous and to be faithful and to be obedient. And he also told him to deal according to his wisdom with Joab, who had murdered, you remember Joab, his commander, had murdered Abner and Amasa. He just killed both of those guys in cold blood. He said, well, you deal according to your wisdom with Joab and with Shimeah. Or Shimei is how it's said, I think. So you deal in your wisdom with both Joab and with Shimei. And Shimei is the one who had cursed David when David fled from Absalom. So he tells Solomon, you be faithful, you be courageous, you be obedient to God. And you in your wisdom, you deal with Joab and you deal with Shimei. And then David dies shortly after that in 971, having reigned for 40 years. So we had Saul reign for 40 years, David reigns for 40 years, and then Solomon formally comes to the throne about 971 BC. Okay, that's where we are chronologically. Now Adonijah, he soon goes in and he asks Bathsheba to secure Solomon's permission for him to marry Abishag the Shunammite. He says, no, he won't turn you down. You're his mom, and he loves you. Go in there and get him to allow me to marry Abishag. Now, Abishag was this young woman who had slept with David to keep him warm when he was old. He didn't have sexual relations with her, but she's clearly connected to David. And so Solomon realizes that he saw this for what it was. It was an attempt by Adonijah to draw support for himself as the rightful king, because he's already got this. I'm the oldest one. I've got the, you know, these other people on my side. Yes, Solomon's, but look, I now have Abishag who's tied to David, and that's an indication that I am the rightful king. It's the hand of God. And so Solomon, you know, he knows what's going on. He realized what that was, and he had Adonijah put to death. And then he followed this by dealing with Adonijah's supporters, those influential supporters, Abiathar the priest and Joab the military commander. He expelled Abiathar from Jerusalem, and he had Joab put to death. So Joab is killed, and then Solomon told Shimei, the man who'd cursed David, see, and thus would be a danger to work against David's chosen successor. I mean, this guy was furious with David when David was leaving. He's like throwing stuff at him and cursing him and all this stuff. And when David came back, he said, no, I'm not going to kill him. But he tells Solomon, you deal in your wisdom with him. So Solomon understands that this guy is no fan of the house of David. And so he tells Shimei, he says, look, he's going to allow him to live, but he's going to do it on the condition that he not leave Jerusalem. Shimei says, okay, that's good. I'm with that. But he stays in Jerusalem, and after he'd been there 3 years, he journeys to Gath looking for two runaway servants. And so when he returned, Solomon had him killed. But he'd agreed, that's good, I'm not going to do that. He goes out to Gath looking for the servants, he comes back and he's killed. Now all of this, you see, is part of Solomon securing his rule. He comes in, there's this tumult, there was this idea, Adonijah's trying to go, Joab's aligned against him, Abiathar's against him, Shimei is there as a threat. And so the way he handles all of this, though, is in a way that he just expels the one. He gives the other guy, says, no, I'm not going to kill you, but if you are disloyal to me again, you're in trouble. All of those kinds of things. And he tells Shimei, you got to stay here. So he's really securing his rule. And the last line of 2 Kings chapter 2 is, so the kingdom was established in the hand of Solomon. So he now, you have this story, he comes to the throne, he then secures his rule through 2 Kings chapter 2, and then at the beginning of his reign in 1 Kings 3 and in 2 Chronicles chapter 1, Solomon gathers all the people at Gibeon. He gets the people, the community, to come to Gibeon, and the Lord appeared to him there and told him to ask for what he wanted the Lord to give him. God appears to Solomon. He says, ask what you want me to give you. And Solomon asked, instead of asking for riches or long life or victory over his enemies, Solomon asked for wisdom and knowledge to govern the people over whom God had made him king. And this pleased the Lord greatly, that he would do this. So God gave him wisdom and knowledge, but he also promised him great riches, possessions, and honor. So here we have Solomon, God is saying, I am going to make you wise. I'm going to give you knowledge. And he also says, I'm going to give you these other things. Well, Solomon's wisdom, it's promptly demonstrated. You know the story well, it's a very famous story. But he goes there and his wisdom is then promptly demonstrated before the people in his handling of this dispute between two prostitutes about the identity of a newborn. They each had a newborn baby, okay, born within 3 days of each other. And the allegation that's made is that one of the prostitutes' newborns, the newborn of one of the prostitutes had died in the night, and that she'd switched the dead baby for the living one and then claimed the living one was hers. Well, that's a classic case of she said, she said. I mean, it's going to be, you see, very difficult for a judicial system to do justice, because it's difficult to get at the truth. There's only two people there. You know, there's no family, that they're prostitutes. There are only two people who are in the know, and they're at odds. Well, what's a person who's charged with administering justice to do? How do you break through and get at the truth? Well, Solomon, of course, he orders the baby be cut in half so they each can have part. And then he discerns from the reaction of the prostitutes to what he was proposing who the real mother was. So the one who wasn't her baby, she said, yeah, go ahead, that's a good idea, let's kill the baby. The other one's going, no, take it. Solomon goes, now I know. You see, and see, that was a manifestation, you see, of his wisdom in the administration of justice. So that you get that right after God says, I'm giving you this gift, going to make you wise, you're going to have knowledge, and then you have that. And as Solomon was renowned for his wisdom, I'm going to see if this works. Yes. In 1 Kings 4:29 to 34, it says, and God gave Solomon wisdom and understanding beyond measure, and breadth of mind like the sand of the seashore. You see, that's an idiom kind of thing. You see that a lot. It's like sand of the seashore, right? It just means tons. Okay? So that Solomon's wisdom surpassed the wisdom of all the people of the East and all the wisdom of Egypt. For he was wiser than all other men, wiser than Ethan the Ezrahite and Heman and Calcol and Darda, the sons of Mahol. And his fame was in all the surrounding nations. He also spoke 3,000 proverbs, and his songs were 1,005. He spoke of trees, from the cedar that is in Lebanon to the hyssop that grows out of the wall. He spoke also of beasts, and of birds, and of reptiles, and of fish. And people of all nations came to hear the wisdom of Solomon and from all the kings of the earth who had heard of his wisdom. You see, by the way, Solomon's a naturalist. He's certainly not an evolutionist. But you see, there's plenty to know about the world, understanding it's created by God. Oftentimes you have people say, well, if you believe in creation, then you're just a science stopper. That's all there is. No, there's plenty to explore in the world. And he knew, he was given wisdom about all of these beasts and birds and how they live and what they do and how they reproduce, and everybody's just blown away by him. So this is what he's renowned for his wisdom. Indeed, his wisdom's evident in the fact that he's the author of many of the Proverbs in the book of Proverbs, and he's closely associated with wisdom in the book of Ecclesiastes. See, he's like the figurehead of wisdom, the paragon of wisdom. Solomon is that person. And you see his wisdom displayed in chapter 4 in the efficient organization of his government, and in chapter 5 in his diplomacy with Hiram, king of Tyre, David's pal. You see how he has diplomacy there that keeps that relationship going, and it was Hiram who supplied artisans and the material for his building projects. And Solomon, of course, he constructed in Jerusalem this great temple. He built this temple, this magnificent temple of the Lord, including its furnishings, over the course of 7 years. Now here's a cutaway of it, and you can see this is the temple, Solomon's temple, somebody's idea, and there's some room, there's just some things that you can't be sure about how things are. But here you see an image, a drawing of the temple. You see the inside, the Holy of Holies. So he builds this temple there, and he has the Ark of the Covenant placed in the temple. You remember David had brought the Ark to Jerusalem. Well, he now has the Ark of the Covenant put in the Holy of Holies back here. That's what that represents. So there you have that. Now here's another picture of another slide that shows some of the other things, the bronze altar and the bronze sea there. And so it's just a different depiction cut away, but it shows you a little bit. So he builds this over the course of 7 years, and Solomon's faith and love for God, they're evident in his prayer of dedication for this temple in 1 Kings chapter 8, 22 to 53, pays your reading. Just a really powerful prayer at this dedication. And it's also evident in his benediction in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 54 through 61. Now, during that moving ceremony, that dedication of the temple, the new temple is filled with the glory of the Lord. You see, it's filled with the glory of the Lord. The cloud of Yahweh's presence comes and fills the temple, which is God's way of saying, I'm present here in a special way. You see, this represents my presence among my people. And so this is really, this is an amazing thing. Well, Solomon also, by the way, Solomon built a palace complex adjacent to the temple. And he builds this palace complex of 5 associated buildings, including a separate residence for his Egyptian wife. And here's the temple, And then here you have the complex. You've got the court, Solomon's house, the house of Pharaoh's daughter, the house of the forest of Lebanon. You have this hall of pillars, and here you have the throne hall. So here's the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So these are all kind of connected. But he builds that structure. He builds that. It took 13 years to complete that construction. So he builds the temple. He builds this palace complex. And he also undertook numerous other construction projects in Israel. He's building many things. He built a fleet of ships. He fortified and rebuilt the cities of Hazor, Megiddo, Gezer, Beth-horon, Gibeon, and Baalath. So he rebuilds those, he fortifies those, and he built stables for his many horses. So he's on this huge, you know, construction projects that are going on. Now this was really a golden age for Israel. A golden age for him. There was peace and tremendous prosperity. I mean, that's really what people want. They want to live in peace, and they want to have things and abundance, food, housing. This is what people want. That's what you had here. And under his reign, Israel becomes a major player in the arena of international trade and politics. Israel really becomes a major player here. The abundance of the times, it's evident in the quantity of royal rations that you see described in 1 Kings chapter 4, 22 to 28. I mean, there was plenty. There was plenty of stuff. And in 1 Kings 4, 20 to 21, it says, Judah and Israel were as many as the sand by the sea. They ate and drank and were happy. Solomon ruled over all the kingdoms from the Euphrates to the land of the Philistines and to the border of Egypt. They brought tribute and served Solomon all the days of his life. And in 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 25, it says, And Judah and Israel lived in safety from Dan all the way in the north, even to Beersheba, way down south, every man under his vine and under his fig tree all the days of Solomon. And I showed you this last week. And here, as you see, David's United Kingdom, but David and Solomon ruled here. And you see this kingdom, it's a major area. They're getting tribute from the other things. There's peace. David was warring to secure things. Solomon comes in. Peace, as his name means. The temple is built. The good times are rolling. It is a real golden age. And in 1 Kings chapter 10, the queen of Sheba, she came to Jerusalem to test Solomon with questions because she'd heard about his fame. I mean, this was all over the place. The text that I read, people knew that Solomon, there's something about this guy. This guy's really in the know. You can go and you can try to stump him. Go ask him stuff that you've wondered about. Go ask this guy. He's like crazy. He knows so much stuff. So she comes up, the queen of Sheba. Now, Sheba's probably the Hebrew reference to Saba, which is on the southwest coast of the Arabian Peninsula. So she journeys up, and whether she's the queen of a king, you don't know that. We don't know anything really about her. But she's somebody of altitude, and she journeys up there to ask Solomon questions because she'd heard about his fame, and Solomon just blew her away with the wisdom of his responses and with the splendor of his court. She comes in here and she says, she's breathless. She's got nothing to say. She comes in and she said, man, they weren't just talking. Stuff I heard, this is like, you really are super wise. And you really are blessed because I see the abundance here. And of course, Jesus refers to this event in Matthew 12, 42. And in the parallel in Luke 11, 31, says the queen of the south will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it. For she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and behold, someone greater than Solomon is here. Something greater than Solomon is here, meaning someone, meaning him. You see, greater than Solomon. So he uses the Queen of Sheba, that she was so interested, drawn to one as great as Solomon, and Jesus says, one greater is here. And that's the truth. But he mentions that. Now, in terms of wealth and trade, 1 Kings chapter 10, verses 26 to 29, that paints the picture. Now, verse 27 says, "And the king made silver as common in Jerusalem as stone." Now, I think that's hyperbole. But, you know, hyperbole doesn't mean it's meaningless. It means it's a way of saying, man, there was a lot of wealth. There was a lot of wealth. So much. So it was like he made silver as common as stone. So he says that, and he says, and he made cedar as plentiful as the sycamore of the Shephelah. So the good times are clearly rolling. Now, God appeared to Solomon a second time. And he told Solomon in 1 Kings chapter 9, verses 4 to 7, "And as for you, if you will walk before me as David your father walked, with integrity of heart and uprightness, doing according to all that I have commanded you, and keeping my statutes and my rules, then I will establish your royal throne over Israel forever, as I promised David your father, saying, you shall not lack a man on the throne of Israel. But if you turn aside from following me, you or your children," you remember I told you in the psalm, and in 2 Samuel, there was always this caveat about disciplining and punishing disobedience. And he says here, "But if you turn aside from following me, you or your children, and do not keep my commandments and my statutes that I've set before you, but go and serve other gods and worship them," now what's going to be the penalty? It's not going to be the end of the dynasty, because he said that on oath to David in 2 Samuel 7 and in Psalm 89. He said, this is not going to happen. The dynasty, the right to rule, but there may be gaps, because you may be carted off into captivity if your sons are disobedient. So there may be times when one of your descendants isn't on the throne in Jerusalem. Why? Because they disobeyed me and were disciplined and taken off. And you see that's what he's talking about here, because he says in verse 7, "Then I will cut off Israel from the land that I've given them, and the house that I've consecrated for my name I will cast out of my sight, and Israel will become a proverb and a byword among all peoples." So he says this to Solomon. He says, this is very important, very serious, that you always live in obedience to me, that you walk and you fear me and you live in appreciation of who I am. And so he tells Solomon that there in chapter 9. And in light of the tremendous blessings to Solomon, I mean, that God had just poured out on Solomon, in light of that, in light of Solomon's early faithfulness, in light of this warning that God gives to Solomon, it is absolutely heartbreaking to read 1 Kings chapter 11, verses 1 to 11. It says, "Now King Solomon," I modified this here with the dashes just because I think the second clause is parenthetical. I'll explain that in a second. But he says, "Now King Solomon loved many foreign women." It flashed. "Solomon loved many foreign women," and then you go down here, verse 2, "from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the people of Israel, you shall not enter into marriage with them." He loved many foreign women from those nations. But in addition to those foreign women who were specifically excluded from marriage by Deuteronomy chapter 7, he also, along with them, loved other foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, and Hittite women. Now, those aren't the women described in Deuteronomy 7. So he hits both. He's got the foreign women they're specifically prohibited from marrying in Deuteronomy 7, and he's got other foreign women. And the disjunction between the two is complete. The Hittite women there are not the same as the Hittite women mentioned elsewhere, and I have in the past cited that, but scholars that discuss that. But anyway, he goes on, he says, "Now King Solomon loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, Hittite women, from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the people of Israel, you shall not enter into marriage with them, neither shall they with you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clung to these in love. He had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines. And his wives turned away his heart. For when Solomon was old, his wives turned away his heart after other gods." after other gods. God appeared to him. This is apparently powerful stuff, isn't it? But they turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not wholly true to the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. So Solomon did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and did not wholly follow the Lord, as David his father had done. Then Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, and for Molech, the abomination of the Ammonites, on the mountain east of Jerusalem. And so he did for all his foreign wives who made offerings and sacrifice to their gods. And the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart had turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice and had commanded him concerning this thing that he should not go after other gods. But he did not keep what the Lord commanded. Therefore the Lord said to Solomon, since this has been your practice, and you have not kept my covenant and my statutes that I've commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom from you and will give it to your servant. Now this is just as I say, this is absolutely heartbreaking. And the meaning, as I already explained, of verses 1 and 2, it seems to be, at least the way I read it, it's why I put the dashes in there to separate that, because I think that's what's being said. The meaning of 1 and 2 seems to be that Solomon loved foreign women from the nations of Deuteronomy 7 that are specified that you're not to take wives from there, along with foreign women from the other nations. And I said in the listing of those women, Egypt, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, Hittite, they're not in Deuteronomy 7. The only overlap is the word Hittite, and they're different Hittites. Now you say, that seems crazy, but that's the truth. Okay, they are different Hittites. And if I wanted to, I could go and explain that to you. And I have in the past cited people, you know, dictionaries and all that kind of stuff. But there's a complete difference between the two groups. So, but in any event, he's marrying the foreign women, and he's doing that. And, you know, it winds up being something that's destructive. The text shows that all unconverted foreign wives, there's a specific prohibition against marrying the wives in Deuteronomy chapter 7, you see, but all unconverted foreign wives, even those from the nations not specified in Deuteronomy 7, 1 through 4, they pose a danger to faith. They pose a danger to faith. The text says specifically that when he was old, his wives turned his heart away from God and after other gods. You see, the spousal relationship has tremendous potential for influence. The spousal relationship has tremendous potential for influence. And in Solomon's case, that influence wasn't good. His wives turned him away. You say, how could that possibly be? Yeah, you know, you don't love me. You're terrible. You know, blah, 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 blah. You see? Spousal relationship has tremendous potential for influence. And that's why Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 39, instructs Christian widows, which I take that then to mean all Christians. I can't understand why we do widows and nobody else. He just happens to be talking to widows, but he says, yeah, they're free to remarry only in the Lord. Why is that? It is because of the potential influence that spouses have. And so you see it in Solomon's case here tremendously. And it ought to be sobering for everybody, for all of us, to recognize that faith is always in the here and now. It's always in the here and now. Years of faithfulness. Years of faithfulness. Years marked by true wisdom that navigates life successfully in the fear of God does not make faithfulness tomorrow a certainty. Solomon was certainly a person of faith. Read his prayers. Look what he built for God, the temple. He certainly was a person of faith. But you see, the enemy is patient. And you and I have different seasons of life. Right? I mean, there are different things. The things that are that influence us and bother us are different. Life is a journey. There's a different course when you're young and have kids and then you're old and your grandparents and all this stuff. There are seasons of life. But the enemy is patient, and he works on us throughout our lives in different ways at different points in our journey. And that's why we have to always be vigilant. We have to we can't say, listen, you know, well, I was here and I did this in this church and that in that church and did that stuff. Always be vigilant. Because your past faithfulness is no guarantee that you will be faithful tomorrow. You have to keep alive your faith in God because the enemy is after you. He is after you. And you just see that so sadly in Solomon's life. Now, Solomon's sin wasn't simply that he succumbed to the pressure of his idolatrous wives. That wasn't the only thing. You see, he was wrong to have taken them as his wives in the first place. Yes, he was wrong to succumb to their pressure on him as they pulled him into idolatry. Is Solomon responsible? Yes, he's responsible for that. The fact his wives influence him doesn't relieve him of responsibility. It was his responsibility at that point to say, I'm not doing that. I don't care what you say or how long you pull on me. I'm not going to build idols. I'm not going to worship these false gods. I'm a servant of the true and living God. So he's culpable in it without question. But you see, he was wrong to have taken them as wives in the first place. First, in 1 Kings chapter 11, verses 1 and 2, it says explicitly what we just looked at, that Solomon married foreign wives from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the people of Israel, you shall not enter into marriage with them. He specifically said that. And what did Solomon do? Solomon married them. Well, what's God know? You know, I mean, well, God knows a lot. And so he rebelled against God in that regard, ignored what God had commanded, and you see what he winds up facing here. Now, this is a reference, it's a reference to the prohibition in Deuteronomy 7, 1 to 4, against marrying indigenous foreigners. You see, men and women from established foreign communities within the promised land. There is something about foreign people groups established in the promised land so that they're there to reinforce the people in their idolatry and to keep pulling on them from there. So indigenous foreign groups within the promised land that you're not to take wives from there. That's prohibited. And you see that concept and that principle being later applied to the foreign communities within Israel after the exile. Because when they return, what's happened? They're taking wives from the foreign communities within Israel. He says, you can't do that. You see, because with that backing of that community there, there's an increased potential of their sticking to their idolatry and then influencing you. And so this is what he said. So he violated that. And then second, at the very least, Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 17, it forbids a king from engaging in excessive polygamy. At the very least, it does that. It forbids a king from engaging in excessive polygamy, and Solomon's was excessive by any standard. You see, so he's violated that and taking these other foreign wives. But I want to suggest to you and just say to you that a good case can be made that the Mosaic law prohibits polygamy altogether. It prohibits polygamy altogether. Now, I can't develop this now. I mean, I'm going to all of Solomon's story. This is itself a class. Okay? How do you get that? I can't develop this now, and I can't deal with the various texts that are often cited as indications of divine approval of polygamy. I don't think that's what they mean, okay? But what I can do is I can cite you to Old Testament scholar Richard Davidson's study of this topic in his monumental tome, The Flame of Yahweh, Sexuality in the Old Testament. It was published in 2007. Okay? Richard Davidson, The Flame of Yahweh. And you can go read and see. And he breaks down and he'll do the kinds of details that you'll want to have. But I'm just saying to you, I think there's a good case to be made that the Old Testament, contrary to what we always assume, actually prohibits polygamy. In keeping with what God had done in the garden and creating one-on-one and what Jesus said. Okay, so is polygamy there? Yeah, I know polygamy's there. But I think it's contrary. So in any event, we have Solomon taking foreign wives that are prohibited in Deuteronomy 7. We have him, even if you take Deuteronomy 17 as simply prohibiting excessive polygamy, he violated that. But also, if it's correct that the Old Testament prohibits polygamy altogether, well, then certainly he violated that. So these are things. It wasn't simply that he succumbed to the call of his wives. He was wrong to have taken them as wives in the first place. And I also should point out that there are other indications in Solomon's life that not all was well with him spiritually. You see, as time went on, not all was well. Deuteronomy 17:16 forbids an Israelite king from increasing or adding for himself horses for himself, or causing people to return to Egypt to acquire horses. And this was designed, see, this was to keep the king from trusting in his military power. God said, no, you got a king. The king's not to, you know, get this huge army of horses and chariots and all this kind of stuff. He trusts me. You see, so it was designed to keep him from doing that, but he was prohibited from increasing or adding horses for himself. And Solomon flagrantly violated that command. You see that in 1 Kings 4:26, 10:26 to 29, 2 Chronicles, a number of places. Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 17. It also forbids an Israelite king from adding silver and gold in great quantity for himself. And Solomon surpassed all kings in terms of riches. But this is kind of complicated, see, because whether Solomon did anything wrong in terms of accumulating this wealth, it's complicated, see, by the fact the Lord had promised him. In 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verse 12, I will also give you riches, possessions, and honor as none of the kings who were before you and none after you shall have. Okay, I heard that bell. So let me just say what I think is going on there is there's a question of whether Solomon had been self-indulgent in his use of the wealth. You see, in that case, he would then run afoul of the prohibition that he winds up, you see, when he says here, in great quantity for himself. You see, so I think there's room there. Now, I heard the bell. Let me say this, and then I'll shut up. All right. God tells Solomon, I won't read this, but in 11:9-13, that he's going to, as a result of his disobedience, the kingdom's going to be divided in the days of his son, okay? Not in Solomon's, the days of his son. The son will only rule over a fragment. And then God raises up enemies of Solomon because of his disobedience, particularly raised up Hadad the Edomite and Rezon the king of Syria. And then last thing, he tells Ahijah the prophet, tells Jeroboam, he says, listen, you're going to be made king of the 10 tribes of the north that are going to be taken from Solomon's son who sits on the throne. Well, when Solomon hears that, Solomon tries to kill Jeroboam. Jeroboam flees to Egypt, and he stays there until Solomon dies. Solomon dies, Jeroboam comes back, and this is where we get the divided kingdom, and that's where we'll pick up next week. Thanks for your patience.